It's big, beautiful, and currently the highest profile piece of aquatic real estate on Earth, Auckland's Hauraki Gulf. The tussle for the upcoming America's Cup has the world keenly watching the stretch of water. But there's another drama raging beneath the surface. The Gulf, once abundant and productive, is now struggling. Is it overfishing? Kina barrens? By hook or by book, what will secure the Gulf's future? Here's Tamatiri Minesprout.
It's rush hour at Auckland's Half Moon Bay boat ramp. They're all headed to the Hauraki Gulf for one thing.
What are you after?
Hopefully get big fish.
Yeah. Snapper.
Snapper, kingies, everything.
What are you after?
Oh, just anything. Kawai, snapper.
Hopefully some snapper, maybe a kingfish if we're lucky.
I'm usually the one who gets the biggest snapper, so.
She is, unfortunately.
But are there too many of us taking too much?
Most Kiwis wouldn't have an idea of how desperate the situation is. We need to get tougher and stronger. It's no good fishing an empty playground.
They are a symptom of overfishing. They're a very clear example.
Well, you can see North Head there, and the spectator boats are all out in position.
The world's eyes are fixed on the Hauraki Gulf and the spectacle of America's Cup racing.
But under the water, it's a different story. We have fish stock that are depleting and overfished. We have sedimentation, we have pollution.
Nicola McDonald from Hauraki Watchdog, the Gulf Forum.
The future's not looking bright. In fact, the future's looking really dire for the Hauraki Gulf.
A Ngāti Wai and Ngāti Rehua descendant, over decades, her people have watched the health of their moana deteriorate.
When we look at Te Moana Nui o Toi, it's an absolute blueprint. Every island connects to itself. That's part of my unique heritage. So when I see that the taonga that we're responsible for as kaitiaki are either becoming extinct or are diminishing, it worries me and it concerns me. When we see modern day pressures such as commercialisation, the economic triggers, ensuring that we can overfish, that absolutely is a devastation to our conservation and our kaitiaki outcomes.
Since COVID lockdown last year, more and more of Auckland's 1.5 million residents are hitting the Hauraki Gulf. More and more of them are fishing.
Have boats just been flying out the door?
Yeah, they have been, yep.
At the boat shop.
So this would usually be full with new and second-hand stock. Quite a few trailers to sell, just not much to put them on at the moment.
Same thing at the tackle shop.
Really full on, really busy. First in, first served, obviously. But yeah, get in early.
It's good to be in the fishing business.
Yeah.
So the Hauraki Gulf is the biggest recreational fishery in New Zealand.
Hauraki Gulf fish stock specialist, Niwa scientist, Bruce Hartle.
Snapper is the most abundant fish in the Hauraki Gulf. So for example, it's 80% of the recreational catch is snapper, and it's supported substantial commercial fisheries over time. So when you talk about the Hauraki Gulf, everyone talks about snapper, really.
Te kapa moana, te moana nui a toi, the Hauraki Gulf Marine Park. 1.2 million hectares, more than 50 islands. It's always been a productive fishery.
We're people of the sea, we're people of the coast, and we're an island-based people. We know where the red harpooka runs, we know where the Brutus whale migrates.
You know, there's been fishing in the Hauraki Gulf since the beginning of civilization here. By the late 1800s, we started to get commercial fishing. By the 1930s, there are real concerns expressed around the state of the Hauraki Gulf. And then fishing still steadily increased, and by the mid-80s there were real concerns about the state of snapper and other species around New Zealand.
That led to the National Quota Management System, or QMS, being introduced in 1986, designed to limit catch.
Is the current system working, do you think?
No.
Why?
Fish populations aren't increasing. You know, nationwide we're seeing declines.
Sam Wolford from Legacy, a major recreational fishing lobby.
We've got a crayfish considered functionally extinct. We've got problems up and down the coastline with ecosystem collapse.
And Sam, how did we get to this point?
years of mismanagement is probably the immediate response, and a lack of knowledge.
Latest studies say the total amount of fish in the Gulf is less than half the number it was in the 1920s.
We're saying to our ministers, let's have another look at our commercial fisheries and recreational fisheries. It's no good fishing an empty playground, and that's what we've got to start getting real with.
But not everyone believes it's all doom and gloom.
Get a head off that one.
Do you think the current system, therefore, is working?
Oh, I think it is working, yeah.
How much fish did you catch on your last trip?
About 3 tonne of snapper, yeah, that's sort of our target, you know.
So that's 3 tonne of fish over basically a half a day fishing?
Yeah, well, it was over the course of 2 days, but a half a day's work, basically.
Nathan Harvey, skipper and commercial snapper fisherman.
Not to say that, you know, every week you're just going to go and fill your boots. Some weeks you struggle.
He's contracted to fish 120 tonne of snapper a year.
I've been fishing for about 16 years and running the boat for probably 10 years of that, yeah.
It's a bit of a family tradition too, eh?
I've fished all my life in the Hauraki Gulf. Dad's fished all his life in the Hauraki Gulf. Not exclusively these days, but yeah, it's a big part of our income.
Commercial fishermen have long taken flak for overfishing and destructive practices. Nathan uses a type of net fishing called Danish seining.
Would you consider this method of fishing sustainable?
Oh, absolutely.
Guided by the QMS, Nathan says he's doing everything by the book.
Oh, I get sick of social media and, you know, this blame game and finger pointing at the commercial sector.
Do you think the commercial industry has contributed in any way to fish stocks plummeting in the Hauraki Gulf?
Well, I can only talk about snapper, and I don't believe that the fish stocks have plummeted. There's four seine boats now, no trawlers full time, and you're talking about a handful of fishermen these days that actually fish the Hauraki Gulf.
Which brings us to an important question.
Bruce, here in the Hauraki Gulf, what is the level of commercial take versus recreational take?
The recreational catch is twice the commercial catch. It's about 2,000 tonnes. It was taken by recreational fishers of snapper, while at the same time commercial fishers are taking just over 1,000 tonnes.
So 2 to 1?
2 to 1, 2 to 1, that's right.
Coming up, our prickly problem.
Their numbers have got out of control.
How overfishing has turned the Hauraki Gulf from this into this.
About 50% of the shallow reef is kina barren.
50% of the shallow reef.
Yeah.
12 miles out in the Hauraki Gulf lies Hauturu Ōtoi, Little Barrier Island, a jewel in our conservation crown. Millions of dollars have been spent protecting and repopulating native species that live in the forests here.
You're not allowed to land on the island, that's how protected it is. There's amazing tuatara, there's wetapanga.
But next to nothing has been done below the waterline. Nick Shears, Auckland University marine scientist, here to study the degradation of the shallow reefs and the prickly problem below, kina.
Their numbers have got out of control, just like possums might have on the land if they'd been allowed to get out of control. And they've grazed down a lot of the shallow kelp forest. And you can see the light-coloured reef behind us is just, you know, it looks beautiful, but that's actually, you know, bare reef that doesn't have kelp on it and is covered in kina.
Kina, or sea urchins, are devastating the ecosystem.
Currently, we estimate at places like Hauturu, Little Barrier, about 50% of the shallow reef is kina barren.
50% of the shallow reef,
yeah,
is in kina barren.
Yeah. So it'd be like taking all the forest off the top of Hauturu.
This is what a healthy shallow reef should look like. Kelp forests, big snapper and crayfish, keeping kina numbers in check. But this is what the reef looks like at Hauturu. Kina have stripped it bare.
Kina barrens are a visible example of overfishing, right?
Yeah, they are a symptom of overfishing. They're a very clear example.
And these kina are no use to anyone.
when you open up a kina from a barren, more often than not, it'll be very skinny, quite often have brown roe. It's not going to be good to eat.
Booyah.
What we've seen is they've increased in occurrence and frequency. What is clear is that without predators, without snapper and crayfish, kina numbers are free to expand and increase where the conditions are right.
When we see kina barrens, something is seriously wrong and we've got to start taking some big action around it.
The key predators of these shallow reef systems are no longer here. They've been fished out.
So crayfish are widely talked about as being functionally extinct because they no longer play a role in controlling kina in particular numbers. The same applies for snapper.
But recent data shows Gulf snapper stocks may be slowly rebuilding.
I'm optimistic that the snapper stock will improve in the Hauraki Gulf, and that it's certainly in a much better place than it was 30 years ago.
Is it as simple as snapper populations are going up, therefore it's coming back to being healthy?
Yeah, well, the stock's healthy from a fishery perspective, which is great for fishing.
But there's a catch.
For snapper to play a role in the ecosystem, they need to be large. It's the large snapper that eat kina, will eat the larger kina. Large snapper will eat a lot more kina. And it's the large snapper that are the first ones that are removed.
The Hauraki Gulf Forum, along with Mana Whenua, are proposing the idea of marine protection for up to 30% of the Gulf.
At the moment, we've got 1%. It's not good enough. Mm. In fact, it's pathetic. Mm. We need to do better than that. Mm. Future generations deserve better than a 1% marine protection.
Is that something you, as a commercial fisherman, could support?
I mean, yeah, I could support it. I got no qualms with marine reserves, but as long as it's for everybody.
The concern that we have with marine reserves is that you're displacing effort.
Legacy Sam Wolford, though, believes marine protected areas would only see fishers heading elsewhere in the Gulf.
And I also think that there is an ongoing need for education, you know, about the impact that collectively everybody's having on the environment. And it's about limiting your catch, not catching your limit.
Reserves work, Nick Shears says. Just take a look at his office. Aotearoa's oldest marine protected area, Lee's Goat Island.
40% of the reef here was a barren in the 70s when it was established. But what we've learned since is that with protection in places like Goat Island, with the recovery of the snapper and the crayfish, over time you will slowly see declines in kina and a recovery of kelp.
That means more fish, more marine life, potentially a healthier Hauraki Gulf.
The marine protected area can provide healthy, thriving ecosystems. 30% is the very basic. It's not enough, but it's a start. And I absolutely believe with our communities, Kiwis, iwi, working together, we'll get there.